right, let's get going today. Welcome back to Royce Bear's Facebook page, to the NightScaper pre-event. I'm Aaron King. I'm your host tonight. I'm from Photog Adventures. If you haven't followed me or found me, you're not finding any new content lately. It has been a heinous year for myself, and you haven't seen any new stuff coming out from Photog Adventures, but I will be in Bisti Badlands this time tomorrow night, waiting for the sun to finally go down, and then wait a few and several many more hours before the Milky Way core starts rising on the horizon, and it's going to be glorious. A whole week of Bisti Badlands, and I have never been there before. So I'm stoked to get going. I'm stoked to get out there. Those of you who are new to hanging out here during the live stream, if you have any questions, there's a chance I might interject our guest tonight and let them know that there's a question. But if I can't interject, I will save the question to the very end. If you see the thumbs up from Royce Bear on here, because I'm running as him in his chat, so you'll see a thumbs up from me knowing, yep, I got it. I will ask the question later. But if you want to ensure and guarantee that your question gets asked in the Q&A, do your question in all caps. Just write that whole comment in all caps so I can see it quickly when I'm scrolling through the comments. That will be perfect if you do that. So let's get going with the NightScaper pre-event. Tonight's guest is Christine Kenyon. And before I bring her in, I got to show you my absolute favorite picture that comes from Christine Kenyon. I was introduced to her with this image. This is out at Metate Arch or Metate Arch. I'm not entirely certain which is the correct way. I want to go with a lot of vowel sounds since it's possibly Indian Native American. So I'm like, okay, Metate. But Metate Arch out in Escalante National Monument, you will see her dog in this image at the bottom left. And that's my favorite part of this shot. Seeing that good boy staring up at the arch and the Milky Way core, it's such a brilliant shot. I truly, truly love this image. And it gets me excited to get back out there to Escalante. So let's bring in our guest right now, Christine Kenyon. Welcome in. Hey, Christine. And oh, wait, real quick, I will turn your audio on. Hello, Christine. How's it going?
Fine. How are you, Aaron? It's good to be with you.
I am stoked to have you. We have hung out only during the NightScaper Conference 2 years ago. So yes. You and I don't know each other, haven't been out in the nature together. But when you were in Escalante, I noticed on your Instagram that that post with your dog was your very first post on Instagram and had huge amount of likes for a first time post, 500 plus. Yes. Was it just instant success with that one because your dog was in it?
Well, it was amazing because it was my very first nightscape picture, actually. I don't do anything small, I guess, which also is the reason I'm probably getting gray early. But so it took me 9 months to plan the shot, and I learned photo pills. I cut my teeth on a lot of different things while I was planning that. And Tuffy's a girl, but she'll forgive you for calling her a boy.
Oh, I said she's a good boy. That's right. Sorry, Tuffy.
Okay.
Sorry.
Okay, I'm just kidding.
Good girl.
Anyway,
and how
so
did
we
you get her to? How did you get her to act so well behaved?
Well, no.
That?
Here's the thing. It is not a fake shot. However, I used it is a true blend. But she isn't in every picture. So there's a full background shot of nothing. Then there's the shot of me, and I could not get her to sit. So I had brought a remote flash. And so that's why you can see her head so clearly, which I didn't even see until I got home.
Oh, man.
And I couldn't believe the huge, beautiful head that's separated from her. If you see, there's like even a space between that blocky, beautiful head. And that's from the blast of the flash, because I and all the treats in the world wouldn't make her sit that still. So, yeah.
But, well, yeah. She was really good. I mean, the separation between her silhouette behind her, the shadow on the wall, and her just staring straight up there. Are you standing where she's looking?
I am standing. Actually, if you were to see all of the photos, and it's about five of them, I'm actually standing in front of her holding a biscuit.
Oh, man. Well, I interrupted you wanting to know more about your dog, but this shot in Metate Arch, was this your first time out here? Have you ever been out to Escalante and Devil's Garden before?
Well, I scouted it. Like I said, it took me 9 months to, and I had a vision. I actually took, well, not literally a vision, but I took, I sketched out what I thought would be a great dog shot. And so I wanted to include my dogs in my life. And of course, they are a huge part of my life. So I thought, well, let me see if I can find a small arch, because a little dog, no matter how big the dog is, big arches would make it look, you know. So I found this arch, and I wasn't sure how big it would be, but I trucked out there and checked it out and was experimenting with photo pills a bit, and then went back one more time to just check a few more things, and then plotted my date thanks to photo pills and headed out there with her. And we got stalked by a scorpion at one point.
Oh,
but there was Well, it was coming for her, and she was laying in the sand.
Oh, man.
So, I just did my best cavewoman impression and hammered it with a rock.
Kill circle. Go. Oh, man. I have never seen a scorpion in Escalante Devil's Garden, but I tend to go in May. What month were you there? Is there a
This was
time of the
July.
year?
In fact, it was 4th of July weekend.
Okay, so maybe there's more of a chance in that season. That's when I ran into my little adolescent rattlesnake out in
Ooh.
Escalante, was in July. And
Wow.
I ran into it twice within that hour, and it has never left my mind ever since. Now I walk, and
Wow.
every little shadow, every twig I see is a rattlesnake. I'm like,
Oh, yes.
So that scorpion knowledge makes me nervous, but I've never seen one in May. I've been
No,
all
but you're
over that
right.
place.
You're right. Once I saw it, I was looking all around the rest of the night. I wasn't even as concerned for me, but she was oblivious to it. It was about two
Yeah.
feet away from her when I saw it. So,
Jeez, I hope that her hide would have been good enough for a scorpion sting, but that's not something you want to find out. So we're stoked to have you tonight teaching. I guess this is going to be a taste, a teaser for what you're going to be presenting at the Nightscaper Conference, or is this a completely isolated, exclusive lesson tonight?
No, it's going to be part of my presentation, and I just think it's got enough value that I think it has legs, so we
Oh,
should
yeah.
probably move it. It's inspiration and aspiration. It's where you can go with your dreams of nightscape photography and what you might need. And it's not going to be a tutorial. It's meant to just encourage you into different directions to look up, not just out, and just, all the different gear and things that you can do to bring it all together.
Right on. Well, let's not waste too much more time. Go ahead and pull up. Go ahead and grab into your lesson and get set up while I talk to everybody. I'm getting some questions through here. Denise says, I once saw a scorpion in Peekaboo Slot Canyon. Yeah, you got a tight space there where you got to fight off in Peekaboo. So that's an experience that would never leave your mind, too. So with this presentation tonight, if you have a friend out there that has not learned Milky Way photography yet, or if you have a friend that's just getting into it and ready for inspiring and aspiring thoughts, this is the lesson for you. Make sure you share that link. Go ahead and share your screen so we can see the presentation. And I'm going to
Okay, hold
double
just a
check.
moment.
Ah, no worries, no worries. Those of you who are on here, you might have noticed Mary Beth Kaczynski. Hola, I love this message, she says, or this message, this image. Let me read that correctly. Just so you know, Mary Beth is going to be the guest next week. And so if we come back here Sunday night at 7 p.m. Mountain Time, you're going to learn aurora photography, chasing aurora, and the addiction that Mary Beth, poor Mary Beth, is going through. She has famously once told me that she should be a meth addict instead, because there's probably more satisfaction chasing meth than chasing auroras. And yet, when you see her awesome images, you realize that there's plenty of satisfaction. In fact, this year she experienced in March a fantastic aurora, which was brilliant, and had a good time. On your screen, Christine, I'm not seeing what you're sharing yet, so go ahead and share the
Oh.
screen. I think it just deactivated. So try share screen again on
Okay.
Zoom, and we'll be able to see
Certainly.
your presentation. So
Certainly.
stoked for this. Looking forward to get out there, and I'm going to be in Bicester. I will find out if I find any scorpions then in that situation. Lauren said I saw a couple scorpions out at Toadstools last July and a sun spider. I'm not familiar with a sun spider. It sounds nicer. Is it actually more vicious and scary? So for July, it seems like that's the time that things come out. It's good to go out in May. So it looks like I'm seeing the Night Sky Variety Show, and we're ready to go. Let me just go ahead and come over to you, Christine, and take it away.
Great. Well, thank you so much, Aaron. And I want to thank Royce so much for putting on this amazing Nightscaper conference after having a year off. And I'm sure everybody was so disappointed that we, couldn't actually have our event last year. So here we are, and better than ever. And who knows, maybe there was a silver lining to COVID and that we may have even more representation here from around the world, different countries coming together.
Right.
So as I said to Aaron, this is not a in-depth tutorial. Some folks are going to be doing some great tutorials walking you through post-processing and things. This is a tease. This is basically inspiration and aspiration to take you either from the beginner level or whatever level you're at and think about some other possibilities of what you might want to shoot in the night. And so we begin. This is a busy, this is my only slide with a lot of type. And I thought I'll just stick it up front. And that way, if you all want to, later print this out or, I don't know how you'll be able to get a hold of the screenshot, shoot it or something like that. But I wanted to begin with some definitions. And I think sometimes with a few of these, there have been some especially with blends and composites. So let's just begin with sort of what we talk about in terms of nightscape or astrophotography. You know, of course, there's the single long exposure, and that's just going to be one image. And generally speaking, it doesn't require particularly advanced post-processing skills. You could use something like Adobe Lightroom and very satisfactorily produce that image. Then there are blends. They may be made up of one or more foreground and sky captures that's blended in post-processing, which then would require something like Photoshop. And of course, then that would mean you would need to have a few more skills, because now we might be dealing with masking and things like that. Now, here's the thing, blends and composites, they're sometimes interchangeably used. Technically, a blend is when your camera is in one stationary position with the same focal length. So you don't want to be swinging the camera around on the tripod, moving the tripod, changing focal length. So to be a purist, that is what a blend would be. And there are many, we'll go through with the different types of blends, but you know, that's essentially what it is. A composite, on the other hand, will be not necessarily taken in the same place. It is going to be something where you may go out and bank some Milky Way shots that you really like, and then you're in a place where there was supposed to be a Milky Way, but you got a cloudy sky. So so you feel like, dang, I want to get a Milky Way shot from where I was supposed to be. So maybe you photo pills where it would have been and you put a sky in. Or sometimes it'll be, I've got one in here that's actually just a fantasy shot. So for more artistic reasons. But just to note, when you start moving things around or changing focal lengths, the pure definition of these would be different. This would be a composite if you're making any changes along the way. Then, of course, there are astro panos, and they would be single row, which would be traditionally what a pano would be generally in landscape photography. And then there will be multi-row. I imagine you could shoot multi-row in regular landscape photography, but I think it's more applicable to nightscapes, because if you want to capture higher into the sky, and of course you end up with tremendously pixel-rich images when you do that. And then there's low level lighting, which of course is a term coined by Wayne Pinkston and Royce Bear. And then that is what I, you know, if I'm going to use artificial lighting, that's what I want to use. Sort of harkening back to the Tuffy picture, that would not have been low level lighting. So it was practically stadium lighting, but here and there. But you know, you live and you learn. So I'm very, very respectful of parks now and natural places and other people who come out who just simply want to enjoy the night sky. And I don't know if you all know this, but as of a couple of years ago, Arches, Canyonlands, Wanaweep, and Natural Bridges don't even allow it anymore. So we have to be very careful that we treat our environment gently, and that we leave things the way we found them, and that we need to appreciate there could be other people out there who aren't photographers, who just want to enjoy the night sky, and we just want to be respectful of all that. Then we have star trails, which I'm really enjoying more frequently, actually. And those are just long exposures or multiple shorter exposures that you can stitch together, if you will, blend together in post-processing software. And it's just a way for you to capture the travel of the stars and to give motion. And it's very dramatic. It's very beautiful. And then we have star tracking, which I absolutely love. If you want to move into the arena of absolutely drop-dead, gorgeous, spectacular, juicy Milky Ways, then you want to have a tracker. Now, I use the Star Adventurer or Skywatcher Star Adventurer tracker. There are different ones. There are smaller ones, less expensive ones. This is heavy. It's made out of metal. It's definitely, you know, it's in your pack, but I love it. I got the pro kit. So it's got you can put a telephoto lens on it, and it has a weight, a counterbalance weight. So it's pretty cool. And so what else do we have here? And of course, then when you start getting into star tracking, that's going to be another type of photography that is going to force you to press into your Photoshop skills, because you're now it's the opposite, right? Now you're tracking the stars and the Earth is blurry. So, you know, again, it's going to require some post-processing skills that you wouldn't need, for example, in the single long exposure. And then there are then others here at the end that are any combination of these. And that would be, let's just say you show up at your location and it's pitch black. And so you don't have blue hour. You're not going to use, let's just say, any artificial lighting. So you're just going to shoot a very long foreground exposure. And again, location, is determinant of your outcome. Meaning if you're in an area with a lake, you're going to get very good results. If you're in an area with light color sand, you'll get very good results. If you're in an area of pine trees and silhouetted mountains, it's not as good. But nonetheless, it's worth, many of these things are just worth experimenting with and seeing, but your mileage may vary. So just try these things out. But so the long exposure foreground would naturally be blended with an appropriately exposed sky. Then there's star stacking your skies. There's focus stacking your foregrounds. There's a combination of both to put together amazingly detailed, not necessarily complex, but you'll start using even additional software, Starry Landscape Stacker, et cetera, to piece these images together, or PT GUI if you decide to get super clever and do all of the above in a pano. So the sky's the limit, which is making it super fun. The equipment is getting better. And now we have cameras that just do amazing things. And so let's get off the page of all the type and let's move to our first category. I'm actually gonna begin with the beginning, you know, like a single long exposure where many of us start. And it's kind of funny. I started with a toughy picture, but then I quickly went to these. It was so much work to pull that off. I said, you know, why don't we just start it at one? But anyway, so these are lakes relatively near me. And this is an example of, and you're not going to get the greatest quality. I'll give you pros and cons of these. This is basic skills. Anybody can do this. You can process this in Lightroom. Nothing fancy schmancy. Always have a decent tripod so that you have good stability. That's very important. And have a external shutter release or put it on a timer so that you don't have to touch your camera. But outside of those best practices, you can pull this off. The negatives to something like this is you do have a soft foreground. You're not going to get particularly good detail wide open. It's a compromise. It's always a compromise, isn't it? So that's the first. Here are some examples of single exposures. Here's some EXIF data and what I was shooting here at Yellowstone. To give you the reason, if I'm going to go back to this location, the reason I was shooting like this that night is because I was being stalked by really large elk. And I was a little paranoid and I was looking over my shoulder and I'm on this boardwalk and they were silhouetted. It was actually super dramatic, but also really scary. And this thermal pool was putting off. You can't see it right now because I had to wait. I was suffocating on the steam. And then it would part and then I'd shoot and hope that it wouldn't close up in the 20 seconds or so I was exposing. But the elk, they were impressive. So I moved right along. But this is what you can think that you could get. Notice we're not getting much detail in the pine trees. We've got I don't know what you see on your screen, but it's a fairly soft, noisy foreground. But I mean, you know, when you're getting into this, you're pretty pumped when you come back with a shot like this. Now, here is where a single long exposure can work pretty nicely. This is a scene in Colorado. I did not light this. I was shooting a time lapse, and there is a road that snakes around the mountain. And usually I am very upset if I see car lights or whatever, but in this particular case, it completely wrecked my time lapse. But I was like, wow, I've got stills here that have really nice light. So this was illuminated well enough that the exposure is really quite remarkable. This might be my sharpest single exposure shot. This is not, like I said, this is not a blend. So you can end up with some pretty good shots with better light. And this was a fluke. So let's move on to blends. I have enough categories and slides here that if I don't keep moving, we're going to run out of time and Aaron's going to have to kick me off. So he's going to come with that little hook, you know, like in the old days. All right. So
and time.
Right. Exactly. So these are blends and these are probably my favorites. I love a blue hour blend. Blue hour to me is the perfect time. And remember, there's morning blue hour and there's evening blue hour. It's harder to get up for morning blue hour, but sometimes it's advantageous depending on where you are and where the sun is rising and where you're your features are that you're trying to capture, your composition, et cetera. But this is, of course, gorgeous Mount Rainier. This is an area that's actually not too far from the road. I did a little bit of truck camping there while I waited. So now again, pros and cons of particular kinds of methods. So the pro to this method is that you get gorgeous, cool light, and you still have enough light that you can shoot at a really low ISO and at a nice depth of field, and you get all that goodness. On the other hand, you have to wait sometimes, like I did here, till about 2 a.m. to get the Milky Way where I wanted it. And if you're going to be a purist, you just leave everything sitting there and you take a good dog with you who will bark if anybody gets near it. But anyway, so I took a little nap and just waited for my Milky Way to get generally into the right position. And then I hopped out of the truck and just started firing away for like the next half an hour or so, and just picked the one that I liked the best. This is another fall blue hour blend, and this is over in Great Basin National Park. And this isn't zoomed in, it appears to be, but it is cropped in. This is cropped in considerably. It is not a tracked image. It happened to be a spectacularly dark night there. And there's a lot of detail in this Milky Way. It's one of the more impressive non-tracked Milky Ways that I have. And again, some of these, this one would be a little tougher in terms of post-processing because you've got these trees. And again, it's a lot of detail work. I know some students will say to me, okay, like what's the magic button I press? Show me what I do to like make a perfect mask. And I'm like, well, you can kind of get it started, but you know, there's detail work that I do if you really want to come away with a clean image. So there's hours involved. In fact, most of my images take days, not days at a time, but I'll be working 3 images at a time and bounce back and forth to give my eyes some relief. And I, you know, maybe turn over an image in a week or so. This one here is a little more recent. This was last year, July. Oh, it's funny. I should have put the dates of these next to it. Whenever the Milky Way was in this, but it might've been spring. But I head to this area quite a bit. Aaron said he's gonna be out there, I think, coming up soon. Yeah. I'm doing a Save a Star Foundation event actually next week in this area. So, or this week in this area, my gosh, time is flying. So maybe I'll bump into you, Aaron. I don't know.
I'll be in Vistai this week, but man, that area right there, that beautiful area. This shot. You made the most of those distant pinnacles there. I love it. That's a cool crop. I'm gonna have to copy you on that.
Oh no. Yeah. Well, anyway, and the cool thing is you walk along that rim, and it's just what's so fun about areas like this. And I don't want to get too deep in the weeds of composition, but really walk around and frame up shots. You can use your hands. You can use your iPhone, you know, really think about use photo pills. This is a classic photo pill shot. I want to know where is that Milky Way going to be? When is it going to be? Again, I should have written down the dates of when these were taken. And then this is a more morning blue hour. So you're actually shooting Milky Way before this shot because of the nature of sunrise and sunset here. You'd have to wait quite late into blue hour and it would be quite dark because the sun is setting in the opposite direction. Now I love my truck and my truck takes me everywhere. So I always like to get a good truck shot. So I personally think this is a pretty cool shot. So this is again, a blend. This is probably about a 4-shot blend just because the trouble I had wasn't with the Milky Way or the road, it was with the lights. So I was trying to get the right, it was probably more than, I actually probably shot more than that of the lights, but it ended up being like a 4-shot or a 5-shot blend. And I threw dirt. I would run into the scene and throw dirt in the air to give me that cool kind of, you know, vibe of the sand and the dust in the air in front of the.
A cool effect. Yeah, definitely got to do that.
Yeah, absolutely. That's fun stuff. Then this is a recent shot I just posted. This is from last year, later in the year, late summer. This is the Vistai Badlands. This is called Alien Throne, but it actually has a beautiful Navajo name that I can't remember. And even if I did, I probably couldn't pronounce. And this is not a tracked shot. It's beautiful, clear skies there. It is a blue hour, but this is interesting. Notice the shot is a little earlier into blue hour because you can still see just a hint of the last remaining golden light that might be, it was in blue hour, but it was just the beginning of blue hour. And so you can, again, if you sort of shoot throughout that period, you can decide in the end, what is the look that you want? And I liked this one. I thought this was really nice with this little bit of added depth with the touching of the warmth on some of the features. And again, I've got the EXIF data here to show you that this was 30 seconds at F4, 20 millimeter at ISO 800 to underscore that you can shoot at a lower ISO, you can shoot for greater depth of field. This is not a stacked, focus stacked image. I have many students that will come and again, good, it's good practice, but we'll shoot like 20 stacked focus images for something where, you know, I'm not going to say you didn't need any, but remember, look into the lens you're using and the focal length. And typically an ultra wide is at infinity within a couple of feet. And so if your focus point is at the right spot, you're going to get a pretty acceptably sharp image throughout. Could it be better? Yes. I think if you get really, really close to this image, lower left-hand corner, it's a little soft, but you know, sometimes, and I'm going to show you a picture a little later on, where I sometimes consider it artistic to not sharpen everything. I don't always want everything tack sharp. It's a little bit, sometimes to me, it's my own, I guess, just my opinion, a little jarring. It isn't really how we see, and especially in the dark, it really isn't that crisp. It is sort of soft. It's a little nocturnal. So I sort of have more, in recent years, made my Milky Ways a little bit more moody, a little bit softer, a little dreamier. My earlier Milky Ways were definitely a little more, I say, crunchy. So, and again, it's fun to see how your style evolves. And this may be the last one of this group here. This is, again, another lake in Utah. This is a blend. This is not a blue hour blend. This is me showing up on the scene with a few lights, and you can see that the left side of the screen is lit up a bit. And I just thought it added. I think in this particular case, it really works with this image. I really like sort of the basic silhouette in the background. This was the first time I shot at this lake. And when I came back and saw that reflection, I couldn't believe it. I saw it there and I couldn't believe it. But when I could see what I could pull out of it in post-processing, I was blown away. So this is the first image where I thought, oh my gosh, this is absolutely amazing. Oh, wow. And as you can see, this the image here in the foreground is shot at 210 seconds, which helped me with the math. Is what is that? Not quite 4 seconds, 4 minutes?
Worse at math than you, most likely, like so I can't two, help you
two,
much.
Two and a half, no, 3.5 minutes or something like that. But I'm getting, you know, an ISO of 1600 at F4, so I'm greater depth of field, lower noise, and I shoot Nikon, and yes, I say Nikon, I shoot Nikon DA10, or I've got a Z6 now, which I love, and in fact, the shot before, a couple of the ones you just saw were the Z6 with some of the new Z prime lenses, which are delicious. This is the DA10 again. This is another lake near me. This again is a blue hour blend. I want to keep moving here so we don't just showing you different things that you can do. Now we move on to composites. And this is that category where, and it can vary. So most of my composites are legit, meaning that it was all taken in one place, but I might have changed a focal length or pointed the camera in a different direction, but it's like all in the same night in the same place. So this was the Perseids. We had smoke coverage. This is 3 years ago. Horrible, horrible fires. Smoke coming west to east. There was no place in the area to go out and shoot. I wanted to shoot the Perseids. So I pulled out I think it's NOAA has a smoke map. And I found that there was a little tiny piece, a sliver of Yellowstone, it looked like, or maybe just outside of Jackson, where it looked like it would be clear. So I just hightailed it out there, and lo and behold, it was clear. Now, not too long after this shot was taken, by morning, I have really cool shots of the Molten Barn completely shrouded, like the Tetons are shrouded in smoke. It was pretty epic what came in during the night, but this worked. And so use your apps, use your websites and things to scout and figure out how you can take a shot. But this would have been normally a blend. It ends up being a three exposure composite because that Perseid would never be there. And it was so funny. I posted this picture just neglecting to say I had done that. And I had somebody comment, the Perseid would not be in that position. Like, you're right. So because it was actually coming out of Andromeda that night. And I may have a shot of that later on. I can actually show you. This is also a composite. This was in the same area, the same night, but I'm in a different spot. So the moon wasn't exactly there. So, you know, it's in essence real. I kind of liked it. You know, clearly you can kind of see some clouds there. And the last time I checked, the moon isn't in front of them, but I just kind of liked the look. I thought it was just kind of artistic. This is a shot that I'm really happy to say the State of Colorado Board of Tourism has purchased along with a couple of others. This was awesome. Obviously staged. This is a case where everything in the scene is real. Well, the Milky Way is real too, but it's just not at that location. I was on a deadline. So I was like, okay, how are we going to stage this fun looking shot? And that's what we came up with. Now, this is interesting. This is a composite. It looks like it's totally fake, but it's not. I was so inspired by people I was seeing during NeoEyes who were like, I don't know if you remember seeing the silhouettes of like little people on ridges and then
love those.
I was like, oh my gosh, I've got to get that. So I'm like figuring out where I can go in Utah, you know, like driving all over. So I found this area where I had to go down a ravine and over to the other side of the ravine and set up a tripod. And so the problem was it was moving too fast. So it isn't in real time. But they're both from that night and they're both the same folk. I mean, it's almost a blend, but it's not. I mean, it's legit not, but it's what it would have been had I been able to catch it as it was coming by. Timing's everything, right?
Oh yeah.
All right. So here, this is called, I call this tell your stories with your photographs. So this is brief. I don't want to be too long with a story, but you know, there's some photographs that just have epic stories, and I don't know if this is epic or tragic, but you can be the determiner. But I went out to Monument Valley. I wanted to shoot some Astro. I've got Aspen in the back of the truck. I had taken a cat nap. I was going to take everything out and set up and shoot. And I don't even exactly remember the sequence of events because I'm always tired on my trips. But I got out and I realized, oh, that's what it was. I realized I hadn't opened I go to the back of the truck to open up to let Aspen out for a minute. And somehow I pressed a button. Ooh. And when I go back, it's locked. And I go back and everything's locked. I walked around my vehicle, Toyota 4Runner. Okay, Toyota, shame on you. I walked around because I could not have done that in my Honda CR-V. I walked around the car like four times in total denial. Now I had my camera and I had my tripod. So of course I'm a photographer. Now the good news is I could have frozen any other month, honestly, because it can get quite cold there, but it happened to be, I had a jacket on and it was just good enough. It was just fine. And Aspen was fine in the truck. So she never, she was just having a good old time. So taking a snooze. So anyway, so this is my journey through the night to sunrise before I managed to then walk to the I got to know everybody there really well because I had to hang out for another 4 hours until the lockdown. Man. Yeah.
Yikes.
So it was a nice day at Monument Valley. So, but the thing is, I got somebody driving through. Isn't that cool? And then I've got the Milky Way. So this is from one place. The Milky Way wasn't exactly in that position, so that isn't exactly right. But this is, to me, this is what I call time capsule photography. This is sort of like an experience. This just sort of sums up an event. And what is amazing is this picture was, I think, the first picture that hit over 3,000 likes for me on Instagram on my own account, which I didn't even care for it. I thought this isn't even that good, but people had resonated with that folks. So now this is my fantasy shot. This is actually in my neighborhood, but not the Milky Way. And so this is another Milky Way from another place. But I just had this feeling I wanted to sit down and Photoshop and mess around and put something kind of dreamy together. And so, you know, I encourage you to play and have a good time. That's the only one of its kind that's this like surreal and not at all in the same place. Now we get to Astro Panos. As you can tell, I like these lakes. By the way, this keynote is wonderful, but it really butchers your images. So I had to like go in and tweak them, and this is the colors off and it's just kind of funky looking, but that is what it is. This is a three panel, vertical pano, and honestly shot before I had better practices. So this is a 14 to 24 shot at 14. It's either shot at 14 or at 20. And I wasn't overlapping as well as I should have, and I didn't use PT GUI, and I did it all by hand, and oh my gosh. So, a key advice for Astro Pano or any Pano is get a leveling head, leveling base. Absolutely. It's critical that you're leveled out, because if you're moving at all, even by a degree, but especially if you're doing a wide pan, that's a lot of movement, and you'll find that the software can't figure it out. Lightroom's improving, but sometimes it just won't be able to figure it out, and then you're up the creek and you have to either give up on it or spend days like I did trying to figure it out. Now, this was shortly after the, or this was in the same year as the toughie shot. Again, you know, why start with simple things? Just drive yourself crazy with things that are massively complex. But this made me think of the Brad Gold paint episode here the other day, in that this is moonlight. So I wanted to catch the blood moon, and I was the only person there that
Really?
night.
At the windows during the blood moon eclipse. That's surprising.
Unbelievable. And
Wow.
it was freezing cold. It was like I thought I either was gonna get rigor mortis or
Yeah,
something.
exactly.
Oh my
Maybe that
gosh.
was why no one came.
So yeah. So anyway, so this is also a three image pano. And I think this is, again, not best practices. I think these are horizontal. This is not vertical. This is horizontal pano. And then of course I had two cameras rolling. So then the second camera was capturing, and I basically put them in the trajectory basically of where it set. The set point was exactly correct as to what you're seeing. It naturally arced in the sky slightly differently. It would have had been a much higher image to be exactly correct. But I'm telling you, that night was unbelievable because the moon was so bright and I was just bathed in light. And then I was standing, it doesn't look like I'm standing in this direction, but I'm standing with my left shoulder really to that thing in the middle, that vertical, whatever, like a turret or whatever,
Turret
right in the
arch,
middle.
yeah.
Yeah. And so I turn to my left as it starts to go into the phases, and the Milky Way had just popped out. And I actually went, oh, like it was just unbelievable because there was nothing. It was just a black sky. And that was really, really, really cool. So, of course, that particular one that ended with sunrise. And so I couldn't really wait to see it, kind of come out the other side, particularly. Okay, now we have artificial lighting. This is also a blend. This is not a blue hour blend. This is a low level lighting on the inside of this dilapidated old building. Photo pills was absolutely essential here because I needed to know what time of year this would work. And so, yeah, photo pills is your friend. Some people use the photographer's ephemeris. I've never tried it. It is intriguing. I guess I got started in this. And so it's sort of like, Chevy or Ford or whatever you have, or Mercedes. You kind of, if you like something, you might stick with it for a while. So, but this, the inside of this building, the light I had was so low that even though it isn't a single shot, because I couldn't get it clear enough. None, it could have been because the lighting was so low. And I have a few that probably could pass, but it was better if I shot a separate image of the sky. This is metate again. This is without toughie, which means it's not as good a picture, but no, but so there's I love places where you can just come back and just experiment with composition. So this one really is all about the beauty of low level lighting and really, really, really low level, because again, you could have shot this as a single image. It was that low light. It's basically you're trying to balance the stars with the lighting, which is really low light. So if you come out of a lit environment out of your car, you wouldn't even think lights were on. It would take a while for your eyes to acclimate to even see that there is some glow going on in images like this. This is Alto Metate. I guess I put them back to back. That wasn't maybe as strategic as I should have been in organization. But this is also lit. It is also that's a little more light because this was at a distance and the lights were hooked up in a tree. This was on a workshop. And I included this one only because I wanted to emphasize play with even clouds. I'm finding skies with clouds, as long as they're not mutilating what it is you're trying to take a picture of. And this was borderline. It ended up just disappearing. But it's really exciting to see the clouds working with the Milky Way. So don't be deterred necessarily by cloudy skies. I mean, you know, if worse comes to worse, hang around, you might have a spectacular sunrise out in the desert southwest. And then this is my baby. So of course I had to throw this in. And of course we already talked about this at great length, so I don't want to, and I shouldn't even bring this up, but poor Tuffy is in really bad shape right now. This is a bad week, and I don't even know if she, this is a bad week. And I don't want to like break down right now, so we're just going to move on. But she's awesome, and she's almost 13, and she had an injury. This isn't about her old age, which makes it even worse. But but in any case, she's an awesome dog, and she has a great sister, Aspen, who's constantly giving her kisses. So she's in she's in very good hands. I'm a very doting mom. So but yeah, we talked about this, and this was a bit of a challenge in terms, again, of masking, because there's quite a bit of detail in the tree. And I literally, no joke, cut my teeth in Photoshop editing. It took me months. I would tell people about the picture, like, when are we going to get to see it? And I'm like, well, when it looks worthy of looking at. Oh my gosh. I scrapped this so many times and just started over because I didn't know what I was doing. So, you know, sometimes it's worth just taking something you love and just not giving up on it, because you can learn an awful lot by persistence. And this was last year. This is in Colorado. I was asked to come out and shoot this restored chapel. And this is part of my dark skies efforts with my foundation. And so this is a blend. This was taken. This is the reason this is under lighting, is because it's, as you can see, it's quite lit. But I took photographs. If you're going to use lights that are in the image, just take an image without them in it, and then just take a mask and get rid of them. So there are actually some small aperture lights, RGB lights, around lighting up the outside gently. And then we had access to the inside to put the inside lights on. And this was just an epic night. Again, the clouds made the shot, I think. I had a bunch of pictures. This is where the clouds just, to me, just framed the church and everything. And this is just having fun. I appeared in Slug magazine. I was part of a yearly photographer's issue episode or whatever, edition episode. And so I told the guy, the editor, I said, hey, you know, I'll grab the magazine and I'll just head down there and I'll get a shot. And I had no idea really what I was going to do, but I said, you know, I've got this new awning and I even bring like a little rug and I got my dog, you know? So I set the scene up and took this shot and then went to bed and of course cut the lights. And then I was doing a time lapse. And I knew I wasn't going to get the core where I was sitting, but I thought it would be fun to get the time lapse. Well, if you use certain cameras like the Z6, if you don't turn absolutely every auto focus element off entirely on every piece of equipment attached to the camera or the camera itself, it will at times want to focus. So I would get 6 sharp images, 1 blurred images, 1 little sharper, 3 sharp, 2 blurred. I couldn't figure it out. I thought, how can it go back to sharp? And then I Googled it when I got home, and sure enough. So any of you out there that want to do a time lapse, make sure you kill any forms of a stabilization even, or anything that's going to activate that may try to either be stabilizing or focusing your camera. But nonetheless, I got this shot and put this together, and I just put this under lighting because sometimes it's fun to get a little crazy. And again, as long as this wasn't off the side of the road deal, so I wasn't in a national park, I wasn't bothering anybody. I was, as you can see, it's not a very thrilling looking area, literally off the side of the road. I was exhausted. Anyway,
I can imagine.
Yeah. So, so then these are the star trails, which can just be so much fun. And star trails are something that I'll show you two. Well, let me bounce forward. See this one? Notice how thick in trails it is. And then you see this one, not so much. Yeah. So a lot of that has to do with ambient light. So if you want trails more like this, you can either do it with a partial moon, or in this particular case, there's the town of Farmington near Shiprock that actually is illuminating the Shiprock feature and then breaking up the stars, meaning you're not going to be able to discern as many stars on a night with either a moon, some moon, not full moon, but or some ambient light from another town or something like that. So this is an hour-long single exposure. You can also, and this is an hour-long single exposure, but notice, and this is Death Valley, but notice the difference in dead of night with no ambient light, well, other than the stars themselves, and then the other scene where you've got a fair amount of ambient light coming from a town. So you can decide there what you do in terms of when you want to shoot and what you're trying to achieve. And also, an hour is about the minimum amount of time in order to get, I think, kind of like the minimum amount of trail. The next picture I'll show you is even shorter. It's about 16 minutes, and you'll see it's a much shorter trail. So you just have to, sort of figure out what you want to do about that. And I think there was another comment I was going to make. Maybe it'll come back to me. This is 16 minutes. And this was 16 minutes early. This is just about blue hour, which is why you see some sunlight, some golden light on the wood. So this, in a sense, is sort of simulating moon, right? There wasn't going to be a moon that night, but I'm shooting it earlier, so it's a little more mellow. And I just decided this is called As Time Flies By. So these are just different techniques. Oh, that's what I was going to say. There's another way of doing this where you can take a sequence of shorter shots and just put them together with software. The problem is it's not that smooth. It takes quite a bit of effort to get the trails to look smooth. So, if you can, pull this off, there's not enough time to go through the sequence of how you, and I can actually post this on my website, Aaron, so that if people want to come back and actually see how you do this and
Yes.
calculate the exposure, but give me a day.
You got
So, but
it.
I will put that up as just as a PDF download where you can actually just get some details on how to pull this off.
Before you go on to the next slide, can you go back to the shiprock slide? Royce is with us for a second. He's driving and he's able to safely text right now as he pulled off to the side of the road. And he was curious about on that shiprock star trails image, was that LENR on, right?
Yes.
Okay. Can you both explain
Oh,
LENR?
absolutely. Thank you, Royce. That's very good.
Oh, long
So
exposure noise
LENR, long
reduction.
exposure noise reduction, and yes, very good point to many of these images. I would say, in fact, oh, not all, but most of the images use LENR, because if not, you get hot pixels. You just get noise that you don't need. And so the thing to remember about LENR is that it's going to the amount of time it takes to expose the frame is going to be the equal amount of time that LENR takes to work. The nice thing about this, you hang around for an hour and you can pack up once it's done because it's going to take another hour to actually process the image.
Yeah.
So, but you don't feel like you have to stay there. I remember, it's funny you should bring this up because it's another quick, funny story, but I did not know what it was supposed to, I mean, I knew what it was supposed to do, but I didn't know how it worked. So I'll never forget the first time it engaged and I'm thinking, what happened to my camera? Did the battery die? Oh
Why
no,
is
I
it
lost
turned
everything.
off? It's
Thank
all
goodness I
black.
didn't do anything extreme. It was just 30 seconds, I said, oh, it shuts off. But anyway, so this would be an hour long in both of these cases where you're waiting for it to do its thing. Thank you,
That's
Roy. But
intense, intense. While we're still on that topic, I'll add this Q&A in here now. Thor asked, with the 1 hour single exposure, what ISO were you using at that point? I'd expect some noise, he says, and fog. A really great picture. Nice picture, he
oh,
says.
thank you. Well, they were both, let's see, did I give any details on either of these or am I being cagey?
Cagey, yeah.
This was F5. Oh, wait, I have it here.
Oh, awesome.
I have
Yeah.
it. I have it on the iPad. It was with LENR. It is the Z6 with a 20 millimeter F1.8. It is at
Really?
F5.6. It is 60 minutes at ISO 200.
So you had it at F5.6 for 60
Right.
minutes. Okay,
At
right
ISO
on.
200.
Turned out
But
awesome.
again, your mileage will vary. This was quite a bit of ambient light coming in, which is why probably the most successful images with star trails really have a little bit of a moon, like a crescent moon,
Yeah.
something that's influencing your foreground and also not giving you this. I mean, I think this is kind of cool, but it's pretty harsh. I would probably quicker like this look than this look, but I'm happy I've got both.
I
So.
am biased in the same way. I prefer the previous one, less busy.
And I also, and again, you wouldn't, now with the moon, you wouldn't be seeing that glow in the lower right-hand corner, which is the town, which I think also adds, it's kind of, sometimes noise pollution can actually be pretty.
Right, this is really gorgeous.
So that's kind of nice.
And being that you did a single exposure, I'm imagining that everything in that shot from foreground to sky is all just one single image, 60 minutes?
Absolutely.
That looks awesome. Wow, yeah. Really great.
Which is nice because you don't have to, that's a really easy image to process, right? I mean, a star trail, again, talking about the fundamentals and what is, you know, difficult. This would not be difficult. This, in a sense, harkens back to where we began, which is a single exposure image, and then just processing that image when you get back home.
Sweet. Thanks for those questions.
And so everyone... here, I'm looking at the clock. So let me, I think I'm getting near the end here. But so now this is Star Tracker. I absolutely love Star Trackers. They just, they give you detail and nebula. And you see, I guess like you can see these colors, but you see like little purples and blues and little glowy, I guess if you zoomed or if you had like a, well, I'm going to actually use my 400 at some point, but I haven't done it yet. But I understand from some folks that you can get some really pretty nice images. But well, let's just begin with this. I don't want to do too much here because all this is against the Skywatcher Star Adventure. I've got the pro kit. I think the MSRP or whatever is like $399 or $400. I think it's really worth it. It's heavy. It runs on a battery. The battery lasts for a long time. It's easy to set up, actually very easy to set up. It basically, just to understand how it works, it just tracks with the rotation so that it keeps, you're moving with the stars technically. And so the camera is locked onto the stars and then your foreground ends up being blurry. Now this image here, it would be considered a composite. This is because, and actually the other one was as well, it was shot in the same location, but in a clearing, because it just ends up being a mess. So I ended up shooting a couple of these in the same location, but these are composites. And then this here is NEOWISE. And this is my, and it's, again, it's not looking very good on this screen. It kind of made it a little flaky looking, but it looks quite nice when it's just, you know, in its own little JPEG environment. But this was using, and again, I threw the EXIF data on here to just show you. So this is my 400 at 270 millimeters, 30 seconds, f/5.6 at ISO 4000. And you couldn't get this, it's rotating with it. There would be no way you could get the shot without a tracker. So this was just kind of fun. There were other shots out there that were a whole lot better. I didn't. This could have been stacked. It probably would have looked a whole lot better if it had been stacked. But I don't know if you can see in the upper left, the clouds were threatening.
Yeah, I see that little dark spot.
Yeah. So, and then again, Star Tracker. This is out of
Alabama Hills.
Yes, thank you. Love that area.
Me too.
And this is my little, this is the mood picture, like a mood ring. Let's go purple. And then we go aqua now. And then this is Death Valley, and this is a tracker, and this is one of my favorite shots. And I guess it's okay for me to say that when I had my gallery opening in fall of 19, the owner of Picture Line came and actually bid on this. We had a auction for my Save a Star Foundation. So that's in his office. I was very, very honored that he liked this image so much. But this was the Alabama Hills one was the first one where I used the tracker. And I was just standing there, and there were a few people that were not too far from me. And I was just there going, oh my gosh, oh my gosh. And they asked, are you okay? I'm like, check this out.
Are you all right? Are you doing
exactly.
Okay?
you need assistance. And then the rest of these are just inspirations. I'm a big believer. My dad was the chief of the Office of Photography for the Smithsonian. So I grew up in a photographic household, and he always wanted people to see, not simply look. And so I think one of the things to really remember is to look around. Everything is a possibility. And so these few are just, again, this isn't the Milky Way core, but I really liked how it's kind of looking straight up, how the Milky Way is just sort of tangling with this old dead tree. This is a shot I think I'd mentioned where I had taken one of the Perseids and put it in the other shot. This is where they're coming out of, as you can see, Andromeda, upper left. And even though this is no fancy lens and this isn't track, notice it's 10,000 ISO. But nonetheless, you can still pick up these purples It's incredible. It's really incredible. And this is looking straight up. And just and this was a time lapse, but not to really do a time lapse, although I did kind of make it one. It was to try to catch some Perseids. So that was pretty exciting to get home and flick through them and see what I had gotten. This was a couple of years ago when this is actually at my house.
That's
This is my
gorgeous.
mother will watch this and she will see if I gave her credit. So she comes to me, she says, "Christine, you have to come out and you have to take this picture." And I said, "Oh, I'm tired." She says, "You've got to take this picture. If you're a photographer, you've got to take this picture."
If you call
So,
yourself a
I came out
photographer.
and I looked and I set up and I was so happy I did. And again, it's banding and looking really weird on the screen, but it's actually a really nice, clean image. And this is two images because you couldn't get the dynamic range was too great to get the shadow portion of the moon and the highlight portion together. And then this is a single shot. This is again EXIF data there. This is shooting at a little different focal length. This is a 24 mil. And I just thought this was just neat. I just sort of liked, I just liked the look of it. And so it's just kind of fun. It's sort of a little bit artsy and it's the Milky Way and again, sort of thinking creatively. This
Ooh,
was me
cool.
at the end of an evening again at Metate. I was wiped out. I was picking up gear and I
Laying on your
literally
back.
laid down under the arch and then thought, oh, I should get a picture. Now, of course, I couldn't hold it that still. So I just set my tripod up kind of over me.
Oh,
Oh my gosh. Which would have been quite as
nice.
that would have been like a good thing, right? A little a pic of me laying on the ground looking like I'm being pinned to the ground by a tripod.
Right.
But
Three or
anyway,
four
so
scorpions moving in on you.
well, gosh, now that you say that, I didn't even think of the scorpion.
Don't even think about it.
And then the last one, and I have not
This
entertained
is a
this
great
yet.
shot that you captured here.
Oh yeah, exactly. I was riding Hubble that night, man. It was great. So this is courtesy of NASA Hubble, but there are quite a few folks who I think even attend the NightScaper Conference, and I know I've spoken at astronomy groups, and they do beautiful pictures. And so I just, wanted to let you all know that even with the Star Adventurer with the 400 millimeter lens, you can get some pretty interesting shots. Nothing like this, but you can get some pretty amazing pictures. I've seen them. So this is another thing to explore. And no, you won't get anything like this. Of course, I pick things that are so beyond reach. It's incredible. But anyway,
All those different galaxies in the
oh,
background.
sorry.
Oh, no
Let me go.
worries. Go ahead and transition to share just your screen. We can see you full. And I will hang out with everyone real quick and say that I hope that for all you new to Milky Way photography photographers out there, you're thinking, okay, can I do this? Can I do this? Understand that with the current gear that you have, you probably can pull off a lot of what Christine shared. And especially the stuff that goes into the star tracking, that's when you need to buy specialized gear. But for what you have right now, you probably already have what you need. And let's go into the Q&A and hang out with Christine and ask some questions. Now, Royce has been answering the question of the long exposure noise reduction. Let's just start there. Do you tend to use your long exposure noise reduction on anything else except for star trails?
You mean anything but night? Well, I
Well, I
use it
mean, like, do
generally.
you
The
use
only
it
time
for
I
any?
probably it won't. Well, the only time I won't use it is if I'm doing images in succession, as in a time lapse,
Ah.
or if I'm going to be shooting a stacking stars. At that point, but I've done both. I've actually done both, and I could maybe like one more than the other. It just really depends. But I've done as
Gotcha.
far as star stacking goes. I've star stacked with LENR. I've star stacked without LENR. I definitely don't use it when I am doing time lapses. You really need to just keep that flow moving, or you're going to get a choppy image.
Understand that. Well,
Yeah,
let's go.
but an LENR is basically on all the time, pretty much for my nightscapes.
Really? So you do leave it on all the time.
Pretty
Okay.
much.
Awesome. Steve asks, if I'm upgrading from a crop sensor, would a Nikon D850 be decent or better to wait for a replacement model? What do you think?
You can get killer deals on the D850. I've almost been tempted, but I love the form factor of the Z6. That personally, if you're a Nikon shooter, I'm waiting for the next iteration. Probably not that Z9 that's going to be like 6 grand, although it looks incredible, but something that would be a step up from the Z7 and have maybe the backlit buttons of the D850 and just be the next version of that would be what I would be looking at. But listen, the D850s are at a pretty good price right now. And if you've got a lot of glass, it would be native to that body, I would say go for it.
Right on. So those of you who are hanging out with us right now still, if you have any questions for Christine, make sure you write them in all caps so I know that you want me to ask this. I'll go to the next question on the list. That was Thor. We already answered that. Lauren says, this is completely new info to me. I always have my LDNR turned off. Okay, we answered that actually. It's all about long exposure. Lauren asked that, and myself and Royce chatted back to her, and we responded. So let's see what Bob's saying. Oh, Bob's giving some advice here. So I'm scrolling down to the next question. Mary Beth just says, all your images are wonderful, Christine.
Aww, so thank
huge
you.
Props to you. Boom, there's Royce's response. Okay, Alton asks, hey, is Star Tracker Pro or Star Watcher Pro? What do you have?
Oh, it's the Star Watcher, but it's like the Pro kit. It's a white, unless they've changed it, it's a white body. And then I think some of the accents are kind of like a lime green, like some of the things that you connect the camera to. But oh.
Do you have the Skywatch Star Adventurer, or do you have something
different? What did I say?
Well, he said Star
it's
Watcher.
It's the Skywatcher Star Adventurer. I think I said it correct earlier, and then I might have just butchered it right now.
No, it was just that I led you in with his version of the name. He was trying to figure out the name of it. And so yeah. I think what you have is the same that I have, and I know Mary Beth Kaczynski, who's in here, also has it.
Yeah, and it's the same unit, but if you get the Pro Kit, it's a better value because you get the counterweight and you get a few other attachments so that you could put a heavier... put a longer lens on it, things like that.
Awesome. I love the Metate art shot from underneath. Royce is loving that. He just texted that.
Oh, thank you.
Mary Beth says, absolutely love the Z6. She has one as well. Steven says, this was awesome. Thanks for sharing with us all. And a question from Alton says, what's the name? Oh, wait, actually, we just went through that. Awesome. It was a new question about that Star Tracker. So Skywatch Star Adventure, Alton, get the Pro Kit. Yeah. And then Bill asked, how do you set the tracker for following a Neowise comet? Do you have any recommendation?
Oh, my gosh. That was hard. and what made it even worse, let's not go there. I will pull the plug, and no, I'm not endorsed by them, but really right stuff to me. They have incredible equipment. So I had three tripods going that night. I had, I wanted it all. So I had the Milky Way was out. So I had a time-lapse going for a Milky Way, the time-lapse going for Neowise. And I had the long lens for the one I wanted to shoot that I showed you. I was using a Manfrotto, one of their top ball heads, but it's designed in such a way that the way it's designed is not like a fluid ball head all the way around. It'll bump up against sides, almost like curbs. And I could not, so I was fighting equipment. So I was not a happy camper there for a while. I'm surprised I got anything. I basically had to find it. And then I had to zoom in on it, and then I had to keep gingerly moving with it. I would have to tell you, it was an anxious night. It was not easy. I'm not used to doing that, so that's part of it. And I obviously didn't have the right gear for it. And lesson learned.
Well, then let's see whether another question's coming through. I'm looking through the chat right now, and it looks like we haven't got any new questions in. So now it's time for me to ask a question. So sure. When you are coming into this as a complete newbie, you've done some mistakes that I've made in the past. You've probably been able to solve some things and master some things that I still haven't mastered. So when you think about all in all, if you're standing next to a guy who or girl, woman who's never ever done this, what are your top two things that you like to tell them for a piece of advice for a complete beginner into Milky Way photography?
Well, this is not a shameless endorsement of Royce, but I actually started with Royce Bear's ebook, Milky Way Nightscapes. And then I met him at a lake somewhere and I had seen his face on the back of that. I said, are you Royce Bear? It was so funny. But anyway, I think he's got a great guide. I actually had never met him, didn't know him at all. I was just looking for resources. I don't even remember where I found it. But it is a great resource, and there are others out there as well since then. But he was really at the forefront of a lot of this. And then really, I would say, know your camera. I always tell people on a workshop, in the dark, everything is harder. So if you know your menus and you know where things should be set up, and we could take a deep dive into that, but we're not. But really know your camera and have your camera set up to work with you at night. And then I would say the other thing is be patient and have fun. There are time, it's like enjoy yourself, enjoy the beauty. Don't overreach. Like, of course, I just showed you I have several times, but as long as you can laugh through it, which sometimes I did, It depended. No, but just, you know, have a good time. And if you, and you don't, again, I sort of am a little, people could say I can be strange. So starting off with this, like, really difficult stuff, I wouldn't recommend it. But if you're the type of person who wants the challenge, go for it. If not, I think the best way to cut your teeth, as Aaron just said, any camera, mirrorless or a DSLR with an interchangeable lens in the last 5 years is all you need with a good stabilization. And you can get out there into a dark environment, drive maybe an hour or two from home, set up, download the PhotoPills app, see where the Milky Way is going to be, and take some shots. It's a, you know, it's a pretty easy thing to get into on the floor level, and then the sky's the limit, and have fun the whole way.
Absolutely agree 100%. A few great compliments have come through, so I want to give it to you. This was awesome. Thanks so much, Christine, for a great presentation, incredible location and images, and another comment of wonderful presentation and beautiful shots. So I had to put those
Thank
out here
you.
Before the next question.
Thank you so much.
You bet. This question is specific to one part, but I also want to add on to it. Lance asked, what was the app you referenced that you used at Yellowstone to find a small portion of the clear sky? Answer that and tell us two other apps that maybe you like to use for your Milky Way photography.
Okay. It wasn't an app. It's a website. Mm. And it's on my, you know what I'm going to do? I don't have that at my fingertips, but I have a night guide that is a PDF that is super rich and almost everything I talked about. That's already produced, actually. So there's a few things I might have to add on to it. As far what I don't have on it is the star trails advice, but everything else has been, I've had that for several years. I've updated it. And so I can make that a download on my website. But that's a website, and it's either a NOAA website, it's a government website. And it basically is called fire or smoke.
The smoke maps.
Smoke maps or smoke radar. It's something like that. But it was fabulous, but it's not an app. It's just a website. And then my apps of choice are, well, like I already told you, PhotoPills, but then I also use, let me see if I can grab, can I ad lib? Oh my gosh. we're ad libbing.
Yes. Ad libbing is fantastic.
Oh, yeah.
It's pretty much my go-to method.
We're doing it live.
While you're looking for that, I want to say Lauren says, OMG, I met Royce the same way. I bumped into him at Bryce Canyon last summer. Royce Bear, does this happen to you a lot? It's like Royce Bear goes around like Johnny Appleseed spreading Milky Way photography knowledge and just so finding
funny.
Noobs in the dark.
Well, listen, that's funny. I met Wayne Pinkston at Mesa Arch the first time. Isn't that a riot?
Yeah, absolutely.
It's just a riot. I've met a bunch of people in the night. It's all the nuts. It's like you say to yourself, gosh, yeah. You're just as crazy as I am. So if you do use the Star Adventurer, I recommend that you download either SA Console, S as in Sam, A as in Apple Console, which helps you with your alignment. Your polar alignment.
Can you show what it looks like on your phone real quick so they can recognize it? Do you have the app open? Yeah, perfect. PS Align and SA Console. We can see that really well. Perfect.
Great. And then I also use Sky Guide, and I've downloaded Stellarium. It depends on which. And I tell you, the others to me that are fabulous are Weather.
Yeah.
So my weather apps, my gosh, I am just a weather freak. I think anyone's really into photography really gets into weather.
It seems to go hand in hand, doesn't it?
I'll just hold this up.
A little more left. Yeah, there we go. Perfect. There's some good dark sky I fully recommend, and windy are fantastic.
Yeah. So those are good. And so there's a few others, but I think that's the main ones are on the main page.
Awesome.
But yeah, so weather apps really help you with the environment and know kind of where you're, what you're walking into. And then, you know, I think those, the Stellarium and the others that sort of can show you where the constellations are is very helpful as well. And I need to brush up on that. I will tell you, I need to be better versed in the constellations and where things are. I've had students tell me, you know, they actually come more from the astronomy side into photography. And so I've learned where Scorpio is now. So
coming from Steve, we have a question saying about focus, basically. So for verifying sharpness of the stars during nightscape photography, do you recommend a magnification loop? I certainly do, Steve, to use on your screen, or what do you use? How do you get your focus?
Oh, well, I'm glad you asked. So that was part of, I just didn't want to get too deep dive, but now that you're asking. So the way I have my camera set up, and I would imagine most would do this, at least probably more prosumer pro cameras. And that is, I have it set up, and I, you know, each camera is going to be different. So to walk through how I do it, but you can assign functionality to buttons. So I have a button that's designed to give me a one-to-one, like an enlargement beforehand, so that I can actually point at a star and enlarge the star in the screen in the back. And then I can also then verify that focus when I've taken the image by punching the same button. So that's just super, super easy. Punch in, punch out, and I can find the star. Now, one real quick tip that's really important. If you're out there and you say, well, I did everything she said and I cannot find a star, make sure you start off with your lens already at infinity. See the infinity mark and begin there, because these stars are so small that if you're not at infinity, it'll all just be a blur and you will not see any stars.
Absolutely agree. You will find yourself thinking, okay, what's wrong with this camera?
What's
wrong
have I done?
This lens? And all you had to do is just go extremely over one direction on your focus ring. Exactly. So yeah, I've been there after 10 minutes of wrestling with someone's camera and finding out, oh, it was just way out of focus.
And of course, make sure, it goes without saying, make sure that you don't have, especially with you folks who don't have back button focusing, just turn off any possibility of hitting focus, because the worst thing in the world to hear the thing crank and now you're out again and you got to go back and do it all over again. So, and some people tape down with gaffer's tape, but to be honest, I have knocked myself out of focus more trying to do that. So I just don't touch my lens. I just, it's like a hot potato, right?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. All right. Well, we have one question left and it comes from our OG Nightscaper, Royce Bear. Here we go.
Hi, Aaron. Hi, Christine. Great to be here with everybody tonight, although I'm actually recording this on Saturday. In a minute, I'm going to ask Christine one last question, so don't go away. I'm here again to remind everyone of the NightScaper Conference, which is now only 4 weeks away on May 10th through 12th. This is a hybrid conference of 150 safely attending in person and hundreds more attending virtually. We have over 40 speakers from 10 different nations giving over 70 programs and panel discussions, and 30 of those speakers will be at the Kanab Center in Utah to personally make their presentations in front of a live audience and to answer questions. So you'll get to feel all the synergy of people coming together in those live broadcasts. All this is being recorded and archived into the cloud, where you'll get to refer and replay it for up to a year. Virtual tickets are available at nightscaper.com, or you can also go to roycebear.com. Christine, there are a lot of people who don't know that you're also the creator of a movement to help reduce light pollution called Save a Star Foundation. You're very passionate about saving our dark skies, especially in the western states where you live. Save a Star is also a sponsor of the conference and is doing a Nightscaper commemorative poster titled SOS, Save Our Stars, Defenders of Dark Skies. Now, below that title, it showcases a beautiful Nightscape image from each of the 40 conference speakers. So, Christine, tell us more about this project. Who's supporting it? Why are you doing it? And who are the lucky people that are going to get this cool poster?
So Royce is asking us about the Save Our Stars Foundation, and he's wondering who's supporting it, who's behind it. Tell us more about it, and then let us know how we can get a hold of that poster.
Oh, man, yeah. So I'm very, very excited. Save a Star Foundation is going to be, we are a sponsor, one of the sponsors of the Nightscaper Conference, and this was an inspiration. I felt like I needed to do something to help preserve our skies. And with falling in love with the nightscape photography, and very quickly going back in time when I was a young girl, 13 years old, my dad took workshops. This was before workshops were a thing. He took them out west, and we were laying on blankets in Colorado and looking up at the sky. And I was born in the DC metro area, and you didn't see the Milky Way. I mean, you might have seen, I don't know, Venus or Jupiter or the moon, I don't know. Anyway, and so I remember looking up going, that's why they call it the Milky Way. So when I got started with the nightscape photography, I just, after, I guess it was in early 2019 or late 2018, I just thought, I kept mulling, what could I do to give back? What could I do? And so this idea, the German idea, just kept growing. And I, the premise of it, the mission of it, is to harness the influence of the creative community as well as the photo industry, and basically take that as an effort, as a PSA, as a movement that's in a slightly different direction. We have wonderful global organizations that are very scientific and analytical. This is geared more toward creativity, having talks with the photo industry in terms of they are creating the equipment that give us the opportunity to actually capture these beautiful things, and to therefore work to invest back into what we need to preserve dark skies. So it is. There are many approaches. I don't want to go too deep into it, but we also have an education division that we're starting up, where it's going to be some school age children that we can influence in terms of that, as well as we have some consultants even talking about home lighting and things. But primarily the focus is the creative community and how we might leverage and harness the reach of all of these people to make everyone more aware of what you can do in your own home and around your community to help with this issue, because it's extremely doable. It's very non-controversial, which is wonderful. It's not a political lightning, like a lightning rod. And most people would agree, they want to see their stars. They yeah. don't like the incredibly illuminated town they live in now. And yet we want to be smart about the LED lighting and lower consumption of power. But unfortunately, and this will be the last thing I'll say on this, unfortunately, a lot of the conversions are done by well-meaning, I'm going to say with a smile, bureaucrats, who aren't really looking into the fact that they might want to have lower lumens or a different color temperature of light or down lighting that doesn't, cast light into the air.
Yeah.
So they're just so, yeah, it's kind of like you'd think you'd, yeah. But anyway, but the point is we're, you love thy neighbor. And so we're trying to, we come, bearing a peace pipe, and we just want to just educate people and get people to say, you know what, we can do this. We can retrofit, we can do things smart, and we can not only preserve, but we can reclaim some of the dark skies in the Western United States. But we have the poster. In fact, I've got one. I've got a mock-up here. Print it out. Check out that beautiful poster. This is actually a photographic print. When I ordered it, I thought it was going to just be a CMYK dots per inch deal, but it's actually a silver halide, beautiful, gorgeous print. All 40 presenters, we're getting folks turning them in very quickly, are going to each have a square here. Their name is going to be underneath of it. We've got some of the sponsors on the bottom. And we want to be defenders of dark skies. We want to be there, and we want to, be counted. And so I'm excited for this opportunity, and hopefully this will be the beginning of a new movement that can join with all of the others. So a rising tide lifts all boats is the way we feel.
Yeah, absolutely. And I hope we can get ahead of some of these new communities and new constructions and get them to put up the right lights first. Because I know there's places that we could fight, but they just spent tens of thousands of dollars on their lights. They're not going to swap everything out. But it's
And we're actually, it's funny you should say that. We're working on that right now. Now that's not going to be a chief focus, but we're working. One of our board of directors is has run a commercial lighting business for the past 30 years in seven Western states. And so he's, we're doing some really exciting stuff where we're going to have, he has worked with many cities, including Park City. And I mean, you're a Utah guy, right? I guess,
yeah,
I don't know.
I am.
So, so he's actually been doing this. He also did the 2002 Salt Lake Olympics, the lighting for that. So the thing is he's very, very interested and has the relationships already to make these influences. So we're working with one of our board members is a local politician. And so we've got an interesting board, a very eclectic board of folks who bring a lot of different facets to the table, where I think we've got something good going here. So,
please, yes,
we have a website. It's www.saveastar.net. We're going to be rolling out actually at the NightScaper Conference. We're going to be selling our memberships, but you can get a membership online. It actually includes Royce Bear's ebook.
Nice.
So it's a nice bundle.
So if you become a member of it, you get a copy of the ebook right with it?
You get a copy of the ebook. Sweet. You get a really awesome, which I don't have in here, I could hold it up, but you get a really cool looking 20-inch cotton bandana that shows an astrophotographer taking a picture of the Milky Way over mountains.
Yes.
And a sticker and a one-year membership to Save a Star. And we're a 501c3 nonprofit, which is important to say. So we are a charitable, registered charitable organization.
So you said the website was Save a Star, but it's Save Our Stars for the poster. So just everyone knows it's saveastar.net.
The website, yes, our organization is Save a Star Foundation. But we were going to run an event last fall called Save Our Stars. So that we hope for that to be an annual event called Save Our Stars Summit, where we're reaching out. It was really a shame. Just COVID took the legs out from under it. But we already started building conversations with folks all over the West to come together and as a group unite behind some principles. So that's what we're trying to do.
Well, awesome. Well, Royce just asked before we go at the end of our presentation tonight, he's curious, does everyone in person on the conference get a copy of that poster?
Yes, they do. Everybody in person, including the presenters.
I was going to ask that next.
We'll all get a copy. We've got them all. All I'm waiting for, and if you guys are watching, I've got a few more folks, presenters, to get their material into us. Yeah. But yeah, and then it'll be laid out. It'll be sent in and everyone's going to get one. And then there's going to be a free PDF download on the saveastar.net website for anybody who didn't attend, who wants to download it. And and in fact, the other thing, I don't know if we're going to get this or not, but we might be donated silver Sharpie pens that say Save a Star.
Ooh, yeah.
So here's the fun thing we might do. If we do get that order in, we thought we could hand them out. And if you're at the conference and you want to have your favorite photographer sign your poster, you could go around with your Sharpie and have photographers sign the little pic.
Oh, I hope someone asks me. That'd be awesome. That'd be an honor. So to end this up, we'll say Gene says, great presentation, Christine. Many thanks. Heading to Joshua Tree tomorrow night for Milky Way. You inspired me to try a few different things.
Oh, that's terrific.
I hope everybody who's hanging out with us tonight and have been watching, and those of you who are watching this replay later, that you're feeling inspired as well. If you're watching tonight, right now is the beginning of the great time in April, and it's going to be great all the way through into the 20s. And so, and I mean that by the 21st, 22nd. And so you can go now every night and get out there. If the clouds are clear, you can capture the Milky Way. So don't waste any time. Get out there with your camera. So thank you so much, Christine, for hanging out with us tonight. This has been fantastic.
You're so welcome. It's been a thrill. I love to share what I love to do. And there you have it.
Well, everyone, get involved. Get involved with the Save a Star Foundation and get out there to the conference. I hope that you will join us. And if you do come to the conference in person, make sure to say hi. Make sure to say hi to Christine and check out her presentation. So thank you, everyone. Thanks for hanging out tonight. A lot of great compliments. People were noticing that your guitar is mirrored where my guitar is right now.
Oh, man.
And so it turns out that our guitars are side by side. Wow. I have the cheaper one. She has the nicer one.
I have no idea.
I'm teaching myself Tears in Heaven right now. I don't know what you play, but it's been great seeing that people have
actually. The only thing that could have made this event better would have been if there would have been a dog in the scene. But they're like, then it gets crazy. Aspen's not Tuffy's very, very controlled. Aspen would be like the slobber fest, and I'd be knocked off the chairs.
Everyone loves pets, so thank you so much. My cats
thank you.
Are asleep right there, so we have dogs on her side,
awesome.
Cats on my side. So, hey, thanks, everybody. We'll see you at the conference. And if you're back on Facebook next week, Sunday night at 7 p.m., Mary Beth Kaczynski will be talking Aurora photography. So we'll see you guys next Sunday, 7 p.m. Mountain Time. Thanks so much, everybody. See you later. Have a good